All right, good morning, everybody. Welcome back to another day at reInvent. I hope you enjoyed the keynote this morning. And welcome to Architecture 401, Black Belt Networking for the Cloud Ninja. My name is Steve Morad. I am a Principal Solutions Architect with AWS. I've been working with AWS for a little over 3.5 years. And one of the things that I like helping customers with are dealing with their network issues and their network challenges. One of the things that I've seen as a common theme across our customers, and I'm sure many of you are dealing with these same types of challenges, is that on one hand, we really need our networks to support our business and to enable our business. And we want our networks to be able to provide speed and agility and innovation, flexibility, support the elastic nature of the cloud, right? On the other hand, we want our networks to be controlled. We want them to be predictable. We want them to be uniform, standardized. And at the same time, we also have a whole collection of applications that we have to support. We have to support applications that are built for the cloud and might take advantage of some of the networking features a lot more natively. But we also have legacy applications, some applications that still require static IP addresses, don't fail over very well if IP addresses change. They might support multicast. So what we're going to be talking about today in this session, this is an advanced session, it's 400 level, and we're going to be talking about some advanced automation techniques. We're going to talk about manipulating IP addresses so that we can create virtual IP addresses for legacy applications when needed, and we're going to build on that to talk about how we can do things and support things like multicast. And then we're also going to talk about network monitoring and some advanced network monitoring techniques and things that you can do. Since this is an advanced class or session, I'm expecting some existing VPC knowledge. So I'm expecting that you already know what a VPC is, that you already know about subnets, security groups, route tables, tagging. You understand about NAT instances or VPN instances for creating VPN connections across regions. If you're not familiar with these things, there were two sessions yesterday that you can catch on YouTube. Architecture 205, about creating your virtual data center. It's kind of an overview of VPC in general, as well as ARC403 for one-to-many. Additionally, a lot of the things we're going to talk about today are things dealing with things like network as code. There was a session yesterday as well about infrastructure as code that there's a lot of similarities in terms of the things that we're talking about that might be a session that might be of some interest as well. One of the things I'm going to be doing is showing a lot of different code snippets and examples today. I want you to just sit back and kind of relax. Don't feel like you've got to write down everything. There's a website here, I'll also show it up again, where all of the code samples, CloudFormation templates, scripts and things are all available. So you can actually go there. Also, of course, the slides will be available on SlideShare. So you please just feel free to sit back and I'll talk through the different examples and scripts and things. And the idea, I'm trying to give you some new ideas, maybe get some creative juices flowing about how you can do things a little bit differently, and again, take your networking skills to the next level. Also, one last thing is that a number of the automation things that we're talking about will be making API calls, and my scripts and my examples assume that you're using IAM roles for EC2, which is a great mechanism for creating keys and having AWS create and distribute keys to your instances. And so if you don't know much about IAM roles for EC2, again, there are a number of IAM sessions where you can get some additional information about those. So to start out, we're going to talk about network automation. And there's a level of maturity that I've seen customers have with different levels of automation. So there's basic automation that starts with automating your initial network build, that then you can build on that to do intermediate automation, where you start going beyond the initial build and maybe automating a little bit more. But where I really want to start getting you to start thinking about is moving on to more advanced automation type things, creating dynamic component configuration so that your networks can dynamically adjust to your application and your business needs. So starting out with basic automation, we of course have a command line tool that allows you to create, interact with our APIs, And you can do things like create VPCs, create subnets, create route tables, move route tables around, assign IP addresses. And of course, you can take those command line commands and you can create very simple scripts. This is just a shell script. And you can do things like run a command and put it into a variable, like capturing your VPC ID. You can then use that variable to create a subnet that's associated with that VPC. Then you can do things like clean them up. You can delete subnets, delete VPCs. However, one of the things that you'll probably notice in this script is that you have to run the command line tool and run it through another program like awk or sed to try to start getting out information to create for your variables. And so we also have an SDK that allows you to interact with our APIs as well. And this is an example of a PowerShell script. You can also use Bodo or some others where you can create scripts still, and very simple scripts, but now you can interact with objects. So now you're creating a VPC object, and you can reference things like VPC ID, or subnet ID, or subnet name, or CIDR block. And so it's much easier then to start dealing with your creating these scripts so that you're not having to, they're not as brittle, because they're not relying on your grepping and awking your different information so that if the command line changes its output slightly, then suddenly your script stops working. Of course, you can also use CloudFormation. CloudFormation allows you to define resources, and it will automatically create those resources, and it will also handle the order in which things need to be created. So in the previous examples, it was important that you, in your script, handle order. So you have to create a VPC before you can create a subnet in that VPC, or you have to delete the subnet before you can delete the VPC. CloudFormation allows you to create resources, and with those resources, you then have the ability to, CloudFormation will automatically handle the order in which things need to be created, and so you can automate network builds and those types of things. So basic automation is great because you can automate your initial build of your network. You can now start tracking these changes. You can version control and put these scripts into version control repositories, and it's a great start. However, for many of my customers, this is an aspirational goal. They use the console and they create their network because in their thinking, after all, you don't create networks all that often, and so they manually create them, and sure, it'd be nice if someday I could script it. However, there's so much more that you can actually do once you start building that initial network build. Because our networks do change. They might not change necessarily as frequently as applications that are scaling up and down. However, they do change where you need to expand a network. So you might need to create a VPC peering connection from one network to another, or you might want to expand to another region and create VPN tunnels to connect your VPCs up. Or you have networking components that run within your VPC, like NAT instances or VPN instances, and you want to provide high availability for those components as well. And there are also application-specific requirements of your network. Things like your application will use EIPs or have secondary IPs associated with them. And so these are things that change over time, and you want to also think about automating those things. And so when you start moving into the next level of automation, you can also use CloudFormation and build upon your initial creation and your initial network that you've built. And you can make changes to your template, and then you can run the update stack command to automatically add or remove resources, to modify security group rules. Additionally, with CloudFormation, you get the ability to track events. So you'll get a list of all the different events that occurred as part of the creation or the update of that stack as well. And CloudFormation will also handle rollbacks for you. Another type of thing that you might want to start considering is network expansion, so automating network expansion. So in-region network expansion, you could use CloudFormation again and the VPC peering connections type to automate the creation of VPC peering connection. For cross-region expansion, there are a number of different things that you can script to make it much easier to expand and to build out additional regions or additional VPCs that you want to connect to. Your things like scripting the creation of VPCs, the routes, the VPN instances. There's a utility called VPC to VPC that you can check out if you're interested in that will allow you to just run a simple command and specify the CIDR blocks of VPCs, and it will go out and scan your account, look for the VPCs that correspond with those CIDR blocks, and automatically create VPN instances and a VPN connection between your VPCs. You can also manage networking components. So this is an example of an HA NAT script that I wrote and talked about at reInvent about 2 years ago. And at the time, I thought that it was like the most advanced thing ever. It was really, really cool. And at this point, 2 years later, it's now more of an intermediate type thing. But what it did is, and just to kind of walk through a little bit, is that you'd identify two different NAT instances that needed to monitor each other. And they would determine which other instance you wanted to monitor. You would do a describe instances call to get the IP address of that other instance, and then you would do a health check of the instance itself. And then if you determined that that instance failed, you would do a replace route command to send all the traffic to yourself so that you could provide a higher availability kind of solution or option. And again, these intermediate scripts allow you to automate and track and version control, not just your initial network build, but in addition to the initial network build, you have the ability to version control and track any changes that are going on. However, they're not very dynamic. You're hard coding things like instance IDs, route table IDs, virtual IP addresses into the scripts themselves. And so because it's not very dynamic, if you use utilities like auto-scaling that's going to replace an instance with another, it can become a little bit brittle. So that leads us to talk about advanced network automation, where you're looking to create dynamic network scripts. These are scripts that will enable, where you should have automation that will appropriately respond when you have either network or application changes. And you shouldn't have to change the scripts at all as you're doing it. So examples for this would be things like reassigning virtual IP addresses due to an application change or an auto-scaling event. Or if you have new subnets that you add to your VPC, have them automatically get added to the route tables that will route traffic through NAT instances or through VPN tunnels. Or creating and bringing on new tunnels dynamically as you bring new regions online. The approach for dynamic networking is very similar to anything that you would do on the platform itself. You bootstrap instances, you store dynamic information in some sort of external store, and you do change polling, detection, and response. And the standard way that you typically do this are using external stores like S3, Amazon DynamoDB, or a third-party configuration management tool like Chef, Puppet, SaltStack, something like that. However, I don't know about you guys, but I don't consider myself a developer. And one of the things I'm trying to describe with this automation is that there doesn't have to be, you don't have to be a hardcore developer to do some of this very simple automation type stuff. In fact, the way that I consider myself from a development perspective is kind of like a hack in the garden. My wife is the gardener of the family. And you know, if she tells me where a weed is, I can pull the weed out. But if she tells me to go out and weed, she has to be very careful because she doesn't know what I'm gonna pull up. Or if she says to trim back a bush, I'm gonna grab the shears and shh. Right, so I don't consider myself very elegant in programming, but and so these things using external stores and things, it kind of scares me a little bit. Now, as an aside, they really shouldn't. And learning a new skill and interfacing with these services is really easy. However, what about using resource tags as your external store? So AWS resources can be tagged. And tags are great for doing things, and most of us are using them today for identifying things in the console, naming our instances, naming our VPCs, naming our route tables. You can use it to help identify things by project. You can then break down your bill by tags. But wouldn't it be cool if you could tag your resources and say, hey, this is a NATed subnet. Or this is a subnet that needs to be NATed by a specific availability zone. So it looks something like this. Hey, this subnet needs NAT. This subnet needs NAT. I don't really care where I get, NATed from. I just know that I need to be NATed. Or I have a more highly available NAT solution, and I still need to NAT these instances or these subnets, but I need these subnets to be NATed within a specific availability zone. And so you tag your route tables and say, I need this specific availability zone, or I need this specific route table to be go through these NAT instances. And if these NAT instances are, you can see they're in an auto-scaling group, if they're replaced by an auto-scaling group, what I really want is the new NAT instance that comes up to appropriately grab the appropriate route table. So it turns out that you can, and some of you may already know this, but you can filter AWS resources by tags. So you've got this really cool filters feature, and so you can say, I want to filter my route tables by my, and for any route table that's tagged with NAT. Or I want to filter my route tables by any tag that has NAT AZ that is either any as a value or a specific availability zone. So now you can start creating dynamic scripts that can start becoming a lot more intelligent about what it's doing. So to walk through this script, and this is about a 13-line script, so again, for the hack that I am, it's, you know, I can digest it very easily. But we set up a couple variables. So I use instance metadata to determine what my instance ID is. I determine what my availability zone is. I can derive my region out of that. I can figure out what VPC I'm associated with. I can then run a describe routes table command, and I can describe all of the route tables that are using a specific tag that's tagged and that is associated with my AZ. And now I've got a list of route tables. And I can do just a very simple for loop for each route table that's in this list. I want to replace the route and assign it to myself. So think about doing this type of thing for cross-region peering. Similarly, you could tag different resources and say, this is my NAT instance, or sorry, this is my VPN instance. This is the instance that I'm going to use to connect to other, other VPCs, and have scripts that automatically, or VPN instances, that automatically can go out and query and find VPCs that you actually want to join into your network, and can find the instances that it needs to talk to, and can be resilient to a VPN instance failing, and you can replace it. So advanced network automation really doesn't require a lot of hardcore development. Very simple scripts can be written that are very easily understandable and can be very dynamic. And they can be make your networks much more resilient. And they can also make you more easily respond to kind of application or business requirements. And I want to build on some of these automation thoughts as we start talking about different ways to manipulate IP addresses and to do network monitoring. So to start off, there are different ways in which you might want to manipulate IPs. You might have virtual IP addresses that you need to use to support less cloud-friendly use cases. Again, where an IP address changing just really messes up your application itself, and this is kind of supporting some of those legacy cases. You might have some multicast requirements for legacy kind of multicast application servers that require that use cases. And then there might be some scenarios where you need to have kind of floating networks to support kind of overlapping network use cases. So to start with common virtual IP address approaches, of course, the most basic is an elastic IP address. An elastic IP address is a static public IP that you can assign to a region, and you can assign to any instance within a region. And of course, to move that IP address from one instance to another, it's a simple one line command line call to associate the IP address from one instance to another instance and to allow reassociation. Another approach is to use a secondary IP address. So you can assign a secondary IP address to an instance. You can associate a public IP address with that secondary IP address. And again, with a very simple one line API call, you can assign a private IP address to another instance and allow reassociation at the same time. And not only does the private IP address move with that from one instance to another, but the public IP actually goes along with it. A third approach is to use a routed virtual IP approach. And the way that this works is that you create an IP that's unique for that you're gonna use for your application. However, it's outside of the range of your VPC. And you assign a route table entry to say that you want to send traffic to that address, to that instance. Then you reconfigure another server with a secondary IP address, like a sub-interface here, and you use a replace route call to move the IP from, or to move send traffic from one instance to another instance. So when I first heard about that, I thought, that's kind of cool. How do you do that, right? So the way you do that is you first set up like a sub-interface with, again, an IP that's outside of your VPC. You disable the source address checking attribute. So by default, AWS assumes that your instances are not routers and that they should only receive traffic that's specifically addressed to them. However, you can configure that and you can change that by that behavior by disabling this source destination check, which will allow you now to send traffic to that virtual IP to that instance. And then you make a create route API call or change route, and you replace the route to point the traffic to this instance that you've now configured that. So the reason I bring up these different approaches is that there are pros and cons to each one of them. An EIP is great for multi-AZ awareness. You can assign an EIP to any instance within a region in any availability zone. However, it only moves the public IP. The private IP changes. Now we have this nice split-brained DNS behavior that internally, if you are querying the DNS name of the EIP, in most cases your applications will follow. However, part of the premise that we're talking about is that some applications are not going to follow that DNS change very, very easily, right? So that's a con to this approach. The secondary IP approach solves that problem. Now the actual, both the public and the private IP are moving. So that's great, however, it only works within a single AZ because you're moving an IP within a subnet, so that's within an AZ itself. And then finally, the routed virtual IP approach is also multi-AZ aware, and it's moving the private IP address for your applications. However, it's only available within the VPC, and it only corresponds to the public IP address. So which one should you use? Well, of course, it depends, right? Each virtual IP address option supports very specific application requirements. And if you embrace automation and you build into your application development and into your application code how your these different techniques, then your network actually starts becoming an integral part of your application. And your network starts becoming more aware. So instead of having a separate team that manages virtual IP addresses, and a team that handles applications, and having kind of health checks and some, you know, other mechanism for trying to keep everything in sync, you can actually make these networking features, again, an integral part of your application. So a second thing that I've dealt with and talked with customers about is multicast. Now, in my opinion, by and large, multicast has been a little bit of a disappointment. This idea of being able to greatly reduce unicast traffic by subscribing an enterprise across, you know, an entire enterprise into multicast groups and sending one packet that gets automatically distributed, in my mind, it's become way too complicated. And you know, I know many companies that have tried and kind of abandoned the approach. But some legacy and app servers actually still require multicast. And they do things like node discovery, session management, automated failover. So as you may be aware, multicast is not directly supported on AWS. However, it can be implemented by using an overlay network, doing things like GRE tunnels or L2TP tunnels. NTOP has an end-to-end network-to-network utility that can create kind of overlay networks. The way that it works is that you have a VPC, and in fact, with an overlay network, it can even span multiple AZs or multiple subnets. You create a tunnel from one instance to another instance, and you assign IP addresses to that tunnel. And then you create other tunnels in a fully meshed network, and you create an overlay network that's on top of the network itself. So some considerations is that this technically isn't multicast. Right, we're actually creating unicast packets, multiple unicast packets for every member of the multicast group. So it's not a solution for unicast scaling. There's also some additional packet overhead that is added by whatever tunneling mechanism that you use. Additionally, your unicast traffic that traverses the overlay network is not subject to security group rule filtering. So you need to keep in mind that you need to make sure that you're protecting and you're understanding what traffic is going over that tunnel connection itself. However, it may be a decent option for, again, small legacy clusters that you're needing to support, so things like application node discovery or low traffic volumes. This, of course, can be automated. So using the GRE example and using the tagging idea, you can start tagging instances and saying, hey, this is an instance that I want to be part of a multicast community. You can specify the community name if you want to have multiple communities that are running within your network, and the IP address that you want to use for overlay. And then you can automatically have scripts that run and query the tags and discover nodes and automatically creates this network for you. So I actually want to demo this for you. So you can see in my management console, I've got three multicast nodes. Two of them are currently configured to be part of the App1 multicast community and to have two different IP addresses, one's 10 and one's 11. This is my first node, and I have my regular VPC address in the 172 range. I have a GRE tunnel and bridge that's been automatically created. And I have a local IP address that has been pulled out of that tag. And I'm going to use a utility called OMPing, which is a multicast ping tool that I'm going to use to actually ping and show that multicast is occurring over this network. So I've got a second node. And you can see that I've joined a multicast group. And now I'm receiving pings from 10 and 11, but 12 is still not responding. And that's, of course, because I haven't added it to the multicast group yet. So I'm going to add a tag to my multicast node. And this is 12 running over here. And I'm just looking at the log file. And you can see that every now and then it pulls, and it sees that there are two members of this multicast community. And after a couple of seconds, it's going to discover that, oh, I have another third member, it's actually myself, that I need to add to this multicast community itself. So it comes and it automatically creates and sets up the GRE information. And if I now do an ifconfig on this instance, you can now see that I've got my own IP address, and I could ping over the GRE tunnel just with regular ping. And then I can also run OMPing. And you can see that now I have three different nodes that are all part of this multicast community. And they're all multicast. And you can see that they're both unicast and multicast traffic that's being sent over this connection. So another trend that I'm starting to see is that we're having less and less control over the networks that our networks have to talk to and have to integrate with. So we have less control over the network ranges that we're assigning. And that can be because I've got a number of customers that are being pushed into kind of a SaaS model. They develop software that they've traditionally delivered to their customers to run. And more customers are asking their software vendors to run their software for them, because they want to be users of software, not experts in how to install, patch, manage, upgrade the software that they're using. There are also, of course, mergers that companies have and DevOps, where you have developers who are now creating new networks and things. So there are a couple of different ways that you can handle scenarios where you have overlapping networks. The first one is, of course, to use publicly addressable services. So the way this works is that you have your services on one side, and you've got your customers on the other, and you don't really care what the customer networks are coming from, because you set up service EIPs or service load balancers, and you use DNS services like Route 53 to direct your customers to your services. Right? So you don't have to worry about overlapping your networks, because you're just doing everything publicly. It's the most straightforward approach that's available. And it's great when you've got services that don't need to initiate connections from your service to your customer, where your customers are just coming in to you. Another option that I see many customers do is to do a VPC per customer. So you essentially negotiate with the customer, determine what IP address ranges they're using, and you find a non-overlapping IP address, and then you create a VPC specifically for them. This is also a fairly straightforward support approach. It's viable with AWS automation. One of the main concerns that I hear customers have about a VPC per customer is that they suddenly think there's going to be this huge sprawl. And yeah, there will be a lot of networks that you're creating. But if you automate it and you control the creation of those, it becomes a lot easier to manage at scale. Although it's typically best for single tenant environments, because accessing shared resources and shared systems actually just repeats the problem, right? Because now you're going to have to figure out a shared service network that doesn't overlap all of the customer networks that you've created. So a third option that I've seen customers take is a floating NAT network approach. So the way that this works is that you have a network on one side and a network on another side that are identical. And what you do is you create a bridge network in the middle that you use to translate traffic from one side to the other. So in this case, your .58 instance on the left-hand side would actually send traffic to 192.168, and in the middle it would get translated and it would look on the right-hand side like it was coming from 192.168. You could combine this with VPN tunnels. So if you create a VPN connection with your customers, as part of that VPN network, you could create a VPN network that exists within the confines of that tunnel, and then you translate the addresses through that tunnel itself to help you communicate from one instance or from one network to another network. If you're taking this approach, the recommendation would be to create a VPN service tier where you have redundancy on your side and you create your tunnels and your bridge networks through that service tier between your resources and your customers' resources. So this is a slightly more complicated approach. Consider making a shared service for your HA VPN tier. It's viable with VPN automation, so you want to make sure you're automating your VPN appliances as part of this. And again, we also have a number of third-party partners and vendors who provide options that you could consider using. And again, this may be a better fit for multi-tenant type solutions. So now into network monitoring. Network monitoring has traditionally been siloed, or monitoring in general has been traditionally siloed. You have applications that do their level of application monitoring and logging. You've got your server and infrastructure logging, and then you've got your network logging and monitoring. In the cloud, of course, there's limited access to networking devices. You do have some visibility through some border devices like your VPN or NAT instances. However, of course, you don't have access to the cloud's underlying routing and switching. And so thinking about monitoring in the cloud and within AWS, you need to think a little bit differently about that. And to kind of talk about thinking differently, one of the things that I also do is I'm the network administrator for a small Christian school in Northern Virginia called Lorien Wood. And as part of that, being a network administrator, they're a small school. They don't have a lot of resources. They've got a very, very small wireless network that's based on commodity routers. And we currently use OpenDNS for protecting the students. And we do SNMP with CACTI. And this past summer, some new networking requirements came along. And we wanted to have more visibility into what the students were doing. And of course, protecting students, this is an elementary school through middle school, is vitally important. And we're going to do whatever we needed to do to make sure, pay what we needed to. However, like I said, we were cost conscious. And so the solution that I ended up coming up with was because we're running commodity routers, but we're running DDWRT on top of it, I had some flexibility. And so I'm running a utility called URL Snarf that sniffs all of the web traffic that's going across the router itself. I use log rotate D to rotate those logs and cron to automatically upload automatically SCP the information to an EC2 instance that has a custom Python script and a custom PHP MySQL application. Yeah, I did it over the summer during my break. I'm kind of a geek. I don't know what you guys did. But what's cool about this solution is that it's free tier eligible, or outside of the free tier, it's less than $10 a month to run the whole thing. But what it got me thinking about was, so you might be wondering, you know, how does this apply to the cloud, right? Okay, great, your school, that's wonderful. The first thing, though, is that, and I talk with customers about this all the time, it's really focused on the requirements. Network monitoring can mean just about anything, right? It can mean anything from doing deep packet inspection, doing point-in-time troubleshooting, doing forever network intrusion detection monitoring. There's so many different things that it can mean. So you really want to focus on what exactly is it that I want to monitor and find the right tool then. But also when you're doing it, think about scale. Because often when I have a customer ask me about creating like a network tap on the network, I ask them, do you currently, you know, mirror all traffic on your network? And one of the challenges that I didn't want to do with the school was to just suddenly start mirroring and creating a whole bunch of additional network traffic as part of my monitoring solution. And so thinking about what your requirement is, but then thinking for scale, because on AWS, if you have 1,000 servers and you suddenly want to start monitoring them, you really need to start thinking about the implications of all that data that's suddenly going to start coming to your monitoring system. Oops, sorry. So you also want to find the right tool to meet a specific requirement. There are gateway-based solutions, there are host-based solutions. Sometimes you can use just very, very simple scripts, but there might be other tools that you might not have thought about using as a network administrator that you've been using, that you can call upon. So things like job schedulers, like cron, using things like SSH or WMI to push requests out to nodes to be able to get monitoring information from them, using existing logging capabilities, and just sending network information into your server logs. File rotators, and of course, there's a whole lot of AWS partner solutions that will provide monitoring options for you as well. But when you're doing this, you want to think about using different reusable architectural patterns for doing your monitoring. So one pattern, of course, is to use Amazon CloudWatch. Out of the box, you get some networking information, latency information from ELB, and network throughput information from EC2. And other monitoring information from other services. Additionally, you can push your own custom metrics. This is a script that I've used to help customers who wanted to monitor the status of their VPN connections. So they wanted to know whether or not their VPN connections with AWS were kind of up or down. And what it does is just cycle through a bunch of regions, and it checks all the VPN connections, and then it puts a simple 0, 1, or 2 value into CloudWatch. And then you get a nice graph that lets you know the status of your VPN connections. And again, because it's doing a for loop, it's just cycling through all of them. And automatically, once a minute, again, just run this through cron, it automatically puts that information. And of course, because it's in CloudWatch, you can also create alarms, an alarm when your VPN connections are degraded. So it's a very simple, I think this is an 18-line script, right, that solves that problem. It's not really that hard to do, even something I can write. A second pattern, though, is that you already probably have or should have a monitoring infrastructure or a logging infrastructure to collect and analyze logs from your servers. And so you can log network events locally and then ship them out to CloudWatch logs or to syslog or Windows logs or using, you know, our partners' ecosystem, AlertLogic, Cloud Linux, LogEntries, Logly, Splunk, Sumo Logic. We have a whole bunch of different logging solutions and partners that you can use. You can use your existing log infrastructure that should already have been built for scale, so that part's already solved. And typically, really, though, the disconnect as to why we don't use these tools, at least historically, is because of those silos. So if you add your networking requirements into your server log monitoring requirements and the agents that you're running or the information that you're viewing, and if you add your network admins to those tools so they can actually log in and parse and view that information, then it can be a very quick and easy way to get a lot more visibility. Of course, there's a third pattern where you can do it yourself with simple scripts and tools. So things like creating an orchestrator that you can specify what type of traffic or what you want to monitor, send that out to whatever those specific subset of tools are that you want to monitor, store the results, and then analyze and report on those results. So to kind of demonstrate that, I've got a little demo where I've got an orchestrator And I'm gonna do a point in time monitoring to, that's going to use just simply out of the box SCP and SSH to start doing a full packet capture on a series of instances. It's going to be collected by a PCAP collector and then reported. And the tool that I'm gonna use for this is a new partner of ours, CloudShark, to collect and analyze all this information. So this is my monitoring server, and I have a simple monitoring script that will take tags, it'll take security group IDs, or take security group names. So based on a tag, I can specify that I want to start monitoring on any instance that's tagged a certain way or is a member of a certain security group. Additionally, I've given my script the ability to do two different types of monitoring. I can either do full packet captures with TCP dump, or I can run OMPing and test the multicast solution that we were talking about earlier. So I'm gonna start monitoring. So I'm gonna start an OMPing monitoring, and you can immediately see that one of the instances had an issue So one of the issues, my 12 had an issue because it wasn't connected I didn't have the IP address in my monitoring script itself, so I just didn't have enough scripts. And what I'm trying to demonstrate here is that you can get immediate response back, that it couldn't find the address that had been assigned, because I'm only pinging between 10 and 11. But I'm also getting the pings themselves. So I'm also going to start a TCP dump on all the members of my multicast group. And what I'm doing with this script is I'm actually pushing out the monitoring logic that I want my instances to have. And as part of that, there's this monitoring script. Monitor.sh. And what this is doing is determining a name for my PCAP file, and then I'm just using cron to every 60 seconds upload the information. So I'm basically caching 60 seconds and then I'm streaming that up to my collector. Since I started my packet capture, I'm gonna do my OMPing again to generate some interesting traffic to look at. And then now I'm going to stop monitoring. On all the nodes itself. So I'm actually pushing out the monitoring scripts that I want to run, and I'm turning off the monitoring. So this is my CloudShark instance, and now you can see a bunch of new capture files have been added into CloudShark. And I can look at the different captures, I can see the different information that's in here, and I can do things like look for GRE traffic, and you can actually see the full packets of these GRE connections were created. As part of it, you can actually see multicast ICGMP commands that are being done. You can actually look at the different frames, see how you've got GRE encapsulation and the actual IGMP messages that are called. And then you can even see group memberships that are being left at the end of it. And you can see, so after I finished the OM pings that left the membership itself. Additionally, you can see the UDP traffic that's actually going to the different things themselves. And of course, I am capturing kind of the full packet information itself. And as I do that, I can look at like the protocol hierarchy, and I can see different things like there's these TCP data connections. And if I look at those, that's interesting. I've got a bunch of traffic that's on port 2014 for reInvent 2014. And if you actually look at the content of the packets itself, I have Netcat running in the background, just sending, you know, back and forth, kind of a hello world type thing, to kind of show all the different, you know, information that you have or that's available. So as I was thinking about some of these simple scripts that you're doing, I realized that to some degree, I'm actually reinventing the wheel. There are a lot of partners that we have that have a number of different solutions that will provide you with different monitoring capabilities. So there are network monitoring gateways that you can use from a number of different partners, from Barracuda Networks all the way through Sophos. There are host-based network intrusion detection systems that you can use that, again, will collect and analyze intrusion detection information for you. There are network traffic analysis tools and partners like Boundary and CloudShark. Application performance tools, there's just a whole ecosystem. And so another pattern is to look for a partner that has the that solves the needs, your monitoring needs that you have. So again, from a summary perspective, you really want to focus on the requirements. There are actually a lot of tools out there, some that you may have thought of, some that you may not have thought of. Plan for scale from the start, and don't fear doing things just a little bit differently as you're moving, as you're monitoring and doing networking on AWS. So thank you very much. I hope you enjoy the rest of the day.